Hello, I'm Arthur Schmidt, Vice Director with APA Cleveland. I'd like to welcome you to our next edition of Home Chats as part of WePlanCLE 2020, the virtual edition. Today, we are joined by and speaking with Keesha Allen, Executive Director of Home Repair Resource Center. Hi, Keesha, and welcome and thank you for joining us today.
Oh, no problem. Thank you.
So, Keesha, to kick things off for our conversation today, could you give us some background, history, mission, kind of the overall about you of Home Repair Resource Center?
Absolutely. Home Repair Resource Center was founded in 1971 by a group of parishioners who all attended Forest Hill Baptist Church, Presbyterian Church, excuse me, and they were very interested in really trying to curb the fears around the urban sprawl into the suburbs and to kind of support homeowners. So they felt as though their, home values wouldn't be at a loss or, establishing kind of a community. And they also wanted to invite new homeowners in and kind of lead the way as to how to be good homeowners. So our mission is pretty much to empower homeowners to maintain their homes for sustainable and diverse communities. We have an assortment of programs that, have kind of evolved as the world has evolved. Our primary services are our repair education courses and workshops that we offer pre-COVID four nights a week, either at our offices located in Cleveland Heights or specific areas in a ring suburbs or specific areas within Cleveland. We also have financial assistance programs, small incentive grants for homeowners to be able to, help them with the costs of being able to complete a repair. We offer technical assistance with a list of contractors in which we have a Rolodex of folks who are licensed, insured, and bonded. We like to call ourselves the original Angie's List, being that people trusted our referrals to be able to get the job done. And one of our kind of cool programs that we have is called our tool library. The tool library has over 1,000 tools online catalog, and for $25 annually, you can have your pick of over, like I said, 1,000 tools and own them for or use them for a week, which differs from the big box stores that only allow you to rent, for hours, so you can actually get a project done. So we're just everything home. We offer home buyer education classes for first-time home buyers to kind of give them the ins and outs of about being a homeowner. And, even for those tough times when, having a home becomes kind of a burden or a financial stress, we offer mortgage foreclosure and delinquency counseling services as well. So, like I said, we're all about the home, all about empowering, all about supporting and educating homeowners in Cleveland Heights and throughout the county.
So before we get into more about the organization and specifics about the programs and the communities you work in, wanted to get a little bit more information about yourself, kind of your personal passion, what kind of drove you to being part of Home Repair Resource Center, kind of your journey here, and just a little bit more background on yourself.
Absolutely. I started working for a partner agency I was a housing counselor, and given my athletic kind of coaching background, I just really felt, passionate about the ability to be able to help someone achieve their goals and such a huge goal being home ownership. So I was a housing counselor there for a while, and then I got the opportunity to do that here at Home Repair Resource Center as well. And I really, where I was previously, it was the coaching piece and really, helping folks achieve their goals. But once I kind of got here, I realized that, there's a different part of that, that, you can help people get the home, but it's even more gratifying helping people maintain that home and maintaining it in a way that they're doing it. And to be able to help the hundreds and thousands of people that we've been able to help since I've been executive director since 2016, it's just phenomenal. And our team is so passionate. It's almost like, when we're dealing with almost, 2,000 to 3,000 people a year, you would think that, it just one person after another, applications or just another client. But our team is so passionate and they work so hard. Everyone feels like an individual. When you come through the doors, we pretty much embrace the client and support them in every way. And so that kind of drove my passion. I really don't have any desires to, you know, move on or do anything different than this, because the team and the people that we help really kind of invigorate you, and you feel like you never have to really work a day when you're doing something you're passionate about. So I've been really blessed to be in this position and to, you know, kind of lead this team and their ability to help the community as well.
I agree with you there. The ability where you don't actually feel like you're working every day, it's a blessing among blessings, I'll tell you that. So in the beginning, when you were talking about Home Repair Resource Center, you were talking about how it started in Cleveland Heights, right? And now you guys have kind of expanded beyond Cleveland Heights. So I guess my question to you is, you know, what kind of brought about that the idea of the expansion beyond Cleveland Heights? And then what are the communities that you have been going to, or the communities and or neighborhoods that you've been going to? Is it based on, you know, who has come to your program, right? If there's individuals coming from certain neighborhoods, is that driven a decision by the organization to say, hey, maybe we should go into this community or neighborhood a little bit more? Just kind of a little bit more information about that.
Yeah. So when I started here, I saw a piece of marketing material that said Home Repair Resource Center, Cleveland Heights' best kept secret. And that kind of miffed me a little bit, because why would we want to only keep these services and these resources to, you know, the 45,000 residents of Cleveland Heights? You know, everybody in the county, everybody in the country needs a place like this to you know, help them throughout the process. So I really took that to heart, and I, you know, talked with my board, talked with my team about how we can strategically expand our service area. That started with kind of touching on other inner-ring suburbs. Inner-ring suburbs have always, you know, really tried to, you know, preserve their housing stock, can remain a suburb, and we really wanted to reach out to other communities. So our first partnership was with the city of Shaker Heights. They have a very similar housing stock, very similar housing problem. Issues. So we did a partnership with them for 1 year, and that's been existing since I've started. Then we picked Euclid. We saw the housing stock, and while it's different than Cleveland Heights, we felt as though, you know, our programming would benefit the residents there. So we kind of identified Euclid. We're looking at other suburbs, primarily University Heights, just based on proximity, as well as South Euclid. But, you know, with everything going on, we're kind of pulling back on that. Now, going into Cleveland, I understood that was a huge feat. And we have a small but mighty team here that we, you know, want to make sure we never dilute our product. And I never want to, you know, overwork my team. So we wanted to kind of target areas that needed the help. You know, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. We want to support residents, support agencies or organizations that are already doing the good work that they're doing. So we really looked at middle neighborhoods. That's kind of a term that's kind of picked up here over the past 3 or 4 years. And those places differ from the high development areas such as Ohio City and Tremont. And they aren't on the lower spectrum of, you know, housing issues, such as maybe the Glenvilles or the Central neighborhoods. So they're kind of, like I said, right in the middle of, you know, either booming or, you know, perhaps not doing as well. So we identified the middle neighborhoods in Cleveland and contacted those CDCs, and they were super excited to partner with us. So we've been doing programming now at Bel Air Puritas in that area. We also do program in Old Brooklyn, and we also have been working with the folks in the Buckeye neighborhood, because there's been a lot of resources being Habitat for Humanity, the St. Luke's Foundation, really a lot of resources dumped in, have been put into that area, and we wanted to kind of be able to support that, especially with the new housing. So we're really calculated as to where we go and how we provide our programming, but again, located in Cleveland Heights, we see clients as far west as Bay Village, and, you know, and as far east as, you know, Chagrin Falls or places out there. So being in a kind of centrally located place, it kind of helps us, but we also wanted to kind of do that outreach and support other communities so, you know, they can be let in on Cleveland Heights' best kept secret.
All right. So you started talking about, you know, some of the clients who've come in and have taken or taken part in some of your programs, you know, being as far out as Bay Village or as far east as Chagrin Falls. The individuals, you know, the that are coming for these classes, I mean, are you seeing kind of a broad spectrum of individuals, be that, you know, first-time home buyers, you know, whether it's, you know, how experienced they are in terms of home ownership, right? First time, or, you know, have the, you know, owned a home for 20 plus years. Have you seen people coming in who, you know, maybe are just starting to think about it, you know, right now, maybe renting from someone and they're just starting to think about like, okay, you know, this is kind of the next step that I want to move up to, you know, kind of, I guess the question is really like, what are the, what is kind of the spectrum of individuals you're seeing interested in your programs? Is it kind of swayed one way or the other, or is there really kind of like a mix of individuals?
Yeah, I think, you know, since I've taken the helm, we've been really trying to diversify our client base by, you know, being very visible on social medias, the internet. Typically, previously, you know, we would, you know, get the 5 to 10 year homeowners who really want to kind of dig in and get some projects done or learn more things. But now we've incorporated our first-time homebuyer course with our repair education classes. This is a model that we presented to Habitat for Humanity as well to kind of be able to merge getting that education, that those brass, you know, tack education information, as well as pairing it with the hands-on repair education. So we've seen our demographic, you know, shift significantly because of these efforts, and a lot of first-time home buyers, a lot of folks just thinking about being a homeowner, kind of getting their hands dirty, realizing what the projects that they're going to have to do, and kind of helping them shape whether home ownership is a decision for them. And then, you know, you have the people who are just curious, people who, you know, want a hobby, want you know, information, crave information. So the spectrum has, you know, run the gambit since I've kind of been here, and we're super excited to see the younger demographic get excited about a home ownership and then completing repairs, as well as, you know, kind of the baby boomers or even later prepare their home so they can actually age in place, right? And get all the information they need to know so they can actually stay in something that they've invested in for 30 years or more. So it's kind of all over. We try to do youth programming as well to kind of get kids excited, young teen programming. So everything house, we kind of make sure that we're including everyone. One other thing as well is that, you know, we've noticed that it's been such a mix of folks that we've been doing classes quarterly that are kind of introductory classes. So, you know, folks feel comfortable, you know, using the tools. So then when we offer a class, you know, we don't necessarily have to go through the history and background and safety of actually, you know, using tools for the first time. We've been adjusting to how things have been changing with our demographic, and we're just excited that, you know, so many more people understand what we do and allow us to, you know, help them.
So the individuals that are coming in, I'm curious, you know, and I don't know if this is part of kind of the information that they provide to you, you know, prior to the class or while they're in the class, but are you seeing more individuals who are taking part of the programs who are, who have ownership of homes that are, I guess, considered older homes, right? Like, let's say, you know, 15, 20 plus year older, you know, maybe even some century old homes, right? Or, you know, are you seeing it that, it, you know, it's maybe newer homes still that folks are coming in? I guess my question is more of, is there seem to be kind of a little bit of a trend of those who are coming in to take the classes, you know, the homes that they're dealing with? Is it more on kind of the 20 plus year homes, or is it kind of all over the bracket?
Typically, especially being located in Cleveland Heights, working with entering suburbs, those century homes are typically what folks are kind of interested in. One thing that's been interesting with the boom of the cable networks, television shows, and showing people how to fix their homes in a matter of 30 minutes, a 30-minute segment, has really intrigued folks. And they oftentimes realize that, you know, it doesn't happen that fast. Right. So the housing stock, and, you know, unless you, you know, go outside of the inner ring suburbs, further south, further east, further west, most of the homes are going to be in the range of 70 to, like I said, the century year old mark. Mm-hmm. So seeing folks get excited about, you know, purchasing a home that, you know, may not be at the highest point of their pre-approval, and understanding that sweat equity is going to be something that holds value from, you know, from now until, you know, they move on to another place is something I think folks get excited about. The newer homes, they come with, you know, that new home smell and that satisfaction of realizing or understanding that you may not have to do something right away, but eventually you're going to have to do something, whether it was built, you know, yesterday or, you know, in 1920. Really just letting folks know, you know, basic systems, you know, things that are in every house. You know, and letting them understand they have the power to improve it. They have the power to make it what they want. It is really exciting. Older homes we typically work with, and the people who come in are intrigued by, like I said, making it theirs, having that sweat equity, and you know, using renting the tool, doing the project, and feeling that sense of accomplishment afterwards.
I'm curious, like the first time home buyers, because I think back to my experience of entering into to that realm and the abundance of questions that I know I threw at both my parents, my in-laws, and any family member who would listen to me on what I should or shouldn't do. Are you seeing, you know, the first time home buyers that are coming in? I know that you had mentioned that you had the financial course, which I can speak from experience is incredibly helpful. It kind of sets you up to understand that component of it. But are you seeing those first time home buyers, whether, you know, through the financial course, moving over into some of the other programs, those individuals who haven't bought the house yet, but are trying to kind of acquire the skill set that they may or may not, or in some cases will need eventually to kind of own their home? Or again, is it more of, you know, they have bought the home and then they realize that, oh man, I don't know how to do this. And, you know, want to learn how to do it on their own, I guess.
Yeah, it's a good mix of both. The first time home buyer, I think, gets excited going through the course to realize that, you know, we provide, you know, these additional resources. So I think it gets them excited. Crucial piece is having access to tools to be able to complete those repairs is something that they, you know, people really are attracted to. I think it's a good healthy mix of folks, you know, wanting to prepare. And you mentioned the financial piece. A lot of times folks think that they're ready. Mm-hmm. Both, you know, with the hands-on thing as well as the financial piece. And a lot of times folks go through our home buyer education course and realize that, you know, the responsibility of owning a home is not something that's suited for them right now. Whether it be financially, whether it be their ability to maintain the home, all these kind of factors. So I think, you know, when we talk about our mission statement and empowering folks, it empowers them to make decisions so they can see what's out in front of them. And be able to make a sound decision so there's going to be no regret. Now, you know, you can't say there's just never going to be any regret with the home because you're going to constantly have to, you know, make changes and make repairs to the home. But, you know, having that confidence, having that knowledge, having that understanding is something I think is invaluable. And from the first time home buyer to the, like I said, the senior who's planning the age in place in their home, I feel as though they get kind of all the pieces that are kind of involved, and our team is just so dedicated that people feel very, very what's a good word for it? People feel great. They feel supported throughout the process, even if it's not for them. We have tons of renters who take a lot of our classes, and they always say, "When I'm ready, I'm going to be really ready now." Yeah. And that's a good feeling to know that, you know, we're not just targeting, you know, the homeowner. Mm-hmm. We're targeting folks who are thinking about home, and we just try to provide, you know, everything that's home.
Is there kind of like a common theme or maybe a common misconception, might be the better word, from some of the individuals who are either, like you said, first time home buyers, planning to purchase their first home, or is in that renters group that's learning, right? Is there anything that like seems to pop up when they're, you know, either part of the financial course or part of the learning programs that, you know, you consistently hear amongst them, like, oh man, I didn't realize, like, I didn't think about that, right? Or, you know, I didn't think this was going to be as much work or as involved as I thought it would be as they're kind of preparing.
Yeah, I think even when I used to, you know, teach the homebuyer education course, a lot of folks have the misconception that homeownership is bona fide cheaper than you know, being a renter. Mm-hmm. But a lot of folks, you know, it's not just your mortgage payment. You have your insurance every month, you have your taxes, and you have the interest that you're going to be paying on that. So I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions, as well as you have to maintain the property because you can't call your landlord when, you know, you have a leaky faucet or something breaks in the home. So understanding that it is a great investment to be a homeowner is one thing, but completely thinking that it's cheaper or better than being a renter, I think is one of the misconceptions, because some people aren't able to maintain a home. Some people aren't able to financially, you know, bear higher or lower taxes, higher or lower insurances. So that's one of those misconceptions. And then for the folks that are already, you know, in the home, kind of really making sure that everyone has a checklist. A yearly checklist. That's what we provide all our first-time home buyers in our classes, because you know you can go weeks, months, maybe even years without having to do something to your home, and then everything it turns into like kind of a snowball, and then you get calamity, right?
Right.
So really understanding, hey, you know, check your furnace filters. You know, do a visual inspection of the home. Look at the gutters. You know, check the roof. Things of that nature. For current homeowners are. You know, once you get into the home, it's not over. You're just beginning. And kind of making sure folks kind of understand both sides of, you know, the financial piece, the obligation and responsibility, as well as the maintenance piece and financial or obligation. Because a lot of these places, you know, I know Cleveland Heights has a stringent point of sale or violations program and inspections program. So you want to make sure, you know, when you do have something, you keep it well. You know, when you buy a new car, you try to wash it as often as you can. It's the same with a house. You know, when you buy a new house, you want to make sure it's in tip-top shape because you're going to be one of the largest investments you'll ever make in your life.
Right. I can speak from experience that every time I see our mortgage statement go and see the interest paid, there's a little bit of me that cries.
Yeah.
It's just like, really?
Like, yeah. Like,
we're still there?
One tip we always say, two times a year, if you can, during taxes and any type of financial bonus that you get to make that extra mortgage payment, and make sure you apply directly to the principal, because that's going to save you anywhere from 5 to 10 years of paying, you know, the principal or the interest on that mortgage. So,
Right. No, that's great advice. So I would be remiss if we don't bring up, obviously, that we're still dealing with a health scare, a pandemic right now. That's obviously why you and I are not sitting next to each other, that we're talking to each other from afar virtually here. So again, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask, you know, how your organization is kind of adapting, right, to what's going on currently, you know, the restrictions on, you know, how many people can come together, what you have to do, you know, things like that. So just curious of, you know, as an organization, how you are keeping things moving, even during these times.
Yeah. So, you know, people, it's very interesting for us because, you know, while people are forced or asked to work remotely or at home, the home is on the forefront of folks' minds. You know, if you've gone in the basement and created an office, or, you know, used a spare bedroom for an office, you start to look at things a lot different and you start to see things more often. So thankfully enough, you know, we did do a shutdown right when the pandemic came, but we've been in the office since early May with all those restrictions, masks, you know, all the things that we need for the protocol. But honestly, we've maintained our you know, client communication. We've you know, folks are very, you know, like kind of aware of their home now. So we haven't seen a downtick in you know, traffic of folks. And one thing that me and my team kind of have been marveling at is, you would figure, you know, as we're entering a recession, the pandemic, a lot of job loss, that the market, the housing market wouldn't be as solid. But we've been, you know, having significant amount of participants in our home buyer education program, folks interested in the down payment assistance program, resources to actually obtain a home, because I think people are starting to shift their mind, you know, to the home versus the commute or the car, or the day-to-day routine. So it's been, you know, good for us because we feel like we're helping, you know, and, you know, the things that we do for the community is very hard to do virtually. One thing we've had to adjust is our repair education program. We don't feel comfortable having, you know, folks come into our facility and getting that hands-on education yet. But we have hosted two virtual sessions. One was more of a lecture type, and the second one was on ceiling fans that got rave reviews. I always try to preserve our aesthetic because you can go to YouTube and find out how to, you know, fix anything or do anything right now.
Right.
But
right.
We are the experts, and we always have contractors or trained professionals to be able to, you know, have this interactive kind of, you know, experience with our repair education classes. And we do that as well. We were able to do that virtually for the first time. So we're trying to be creative, trying to be nimble and flexible. But our offices are open by appointment with a required mask. And we just want to help folks because we know that home is really on everyone's mind right now because we're all stuck in them, you know, often. So I think it's helped our team kind of, you know, stay on routine, stay on task, and keep that passion going, because we know that, you know, interfacing with the community is how we thrive.
Yeah, and you hit on two things that I wanted to mention, and I'm glad you did so. So the first thing was you had talked about how you've been doing some kind of virtual programming for like the home repair, but you also hit on the fact that, you know, nowadays people can quickly jump on their phone and YouTube, like, how do I fix X or how do I fix A, right? Mm-hmm. Like a ceiling fan, for example, because you bring a ceiling fan up and I'm just in my head dreading the fact of having to install a ceiling fan. I know in our one room that is just kind of literally and figuratively like hanging over me of like, yeah, I need to get around to do that. But right now it's just as easy as, you know, going on my computer, going on my phone, typing in like how to install X or Y, right? So, you know, from your perspective, obviously you offer kind of that in-person, you know, ability, right? Or that you bring that difference to the table. Has that helped or hurt in any way, especially now during the pandemic, right? Because like you said, the lack of ability of having people coming together, you know, is that something that you guys feel like you're competing against, or because of, again, the value and quality you bring of, again, bringing people in and showing, letting them touch, feel, maybe shock themselves a little bit once in a while. I've been guilty of that. You know, to do that, is that kind of, again, kind of supersede, you know, the ease or the convenience, right, of just jumping and trying to YouTube how to do something?
Yeah. And that's what I wanted to preserve, because I challenge my team to always preserve our aesthetic, because we are genuine in what we do, and pretty special at how we do it. So the benefit I feel of being able to go virtually with us versus YouTube is that, you know, we want to make it interactive. You know, when we did the ceilings fans class, it was, you know, can someone please show us, you know, where your circuit breaker box is? You know, how do you shut it off? Really kind of trying to get folks, you know, engaged. And the benefit as well is that at the end of a YouTube video, granted you can stop and pause, you know, throughout the whole video or go back to it, but you can never ask a question. You can never kind of get that individual personalized question about, you know, maybe someone on their phone can show the instructor and kind of get that advice that I think lacks on YouTube. So I challenge my team to be creative, because, you know, in this day and age of virtual meetings, this is a very exciting one. A lot of my time is doing virtual meetings, and they can get a little drab. So, you know, I really challenge them to make sure that, you know, if we're going to do something like this, it needs to be interactive, it needs to be engaging, it needs to be exciting, it needs to be fun, because, you know, otherwise there really is no point. Everybody can go to YouTube. So my team is doing a great job. We're trying to evolve and think about different projects we can do with folks, and really just try to make sure it's worth people's while to sit you know, through a 45, you know, to 60 minute presentation by us. So we're teetering on, you know, how to make sure we do that and do it effectively. But I've been impressed, especially by our most recent class, with the participation. We had 32 participants in the ceiling fans class who stayed for the whole time and were interactive. And to me, that was kind of a win. And it kind of inspired the team to say, okay, how can we do this and how can we do it even better? So that's where we're looking to go. Tentatively, we were thinking about, you know, welcoming folks in after Labor Day, but we'll have to probably push that back and again challenge my team to figure out how they're going to fill that void and provide this programming to the community.
Before I ask the other question that I had mentioned about kind of seeing this like increase in home ownership or the interest in home ownership, I think during this pandemic, again, you had mentioned now that we're as I am right now in my home far more than what I used to be. When I was working in our office every day, people are starting to see things more, right? That they may have missed otherwise, myself included. Have you gotten any like requests or inquiries about, you know, certain programs or certain activities or lessons that people are looking for that maybe either yourself or your teammates haven't thought about, like, oh, that's interesting, you know, just due to the fact, again, that, you know, folks are in their home more and they're like, it'd be interesting to know how to do this, right? And just giving you guys, you know, suggestions or recommendations. And, you know, have you received those, I guess, one? And two, if you have, are there any interesting ones that, like, when you heard it, you're like, oh, really? Like, folks are interested in, you know, learning how to do that or how to properly do something like that?
Yeah, the interesting you say that, we've been getting a lot of, first off, folks are pretty bummed that they can't come to our shop. And we kind of have HRC fans that take every class and multiple times. So people are definitely bummed and, you know, always wondering when we're going to open our doors and when we're going to get back to our normal services. But one thing has been interesting that you say that, folks are really interested in electricity, which is, like you said before, as well as myself, like wind up shocking yourself. Right. The big one is wiring an outlet, getting your an outlet to go from, you know, knob and tube or regular tube pump to GFCI. And we've gotten a lot of inquiries as to whether we would be able to host a class on that and how we would be able to do it. And my team, again, I was speaking to my board about this and they seemed excited. And I was telling my board, I was like, well, you know, as the manager, I'm thinking of liability. Cause when you're in our, you know, when you're in our spaces, you actually sign a waiver saying that, you know, if anything does happen, but if you're in your home on Zoom and you know, you blow all your circuits or you catch on fire, that's where I kind of get, you know, a little bit worried. So, there have been, you know, a significant amount of interest in classes that we can do virtually. But again, I really want to preserve our aesthetic. I really try to make sure that it can be that engaging experience. My team is challenging me to say, well, you know, we can provide, you know, kits for everyone and then they go home and they do them. And that's something that we're kind of playing around with and trying to navigate how we'll be able to do it. The electric outlets, ceiling fans was actually requested. So that's why we were being able to do that. I just want to make sure, the class previous to that was wet basements and, you know, wet basements is, a PowerPoint presentation, you know, because, you know, you have to get all that information. Trying to find a happy medium between, you know, the lecture style type of classes to the hands-on classes where they can be interactive, is kind of where we're balancing right now. And, I have a great team and they come at me with all different kinds of ideas about what if, or how can we do this? How can we do that? We're trying the best we can. Our next class will be on air conditioning units, which are very relevant, being that the weather that we've been having in Northeast Ohio. So we hope to have a good turnout by that and have folks be as excited and engaged as they were for the previous classes.
That leads me to another question, as I keep pushing this other question off to the side. The kind of, I guess, scale of the classes and programs, right? So you talked about the ceiling fan, you talked about the air conditioning unit, the seminar or lecture, I should say, on water in the basements, the request of kind of the electric. I mean, what seems, I mean, have you guys done, I guess I'll just start throwing some, you know, drywalling, roofing, you know, maybe improving siding. I'm just trying to spit up anything to do with like home appliances, whether it's a refrigerator, a dishwasher, plumbing. I guess just trying to get a sense of scale in terms of how small or how large, you know, you've had classes for to work on certain things.
Oh yeah. I mean, my team has done a good job about marketing our programs. And prior to COVID, like I said, we were hosting 4 classes a week, whether they be on site or out in the community. And you mentioned all the highlights. We run the gamut of classes from, you know, roofing, gutters, tub pointing. That's one we're probably going to do virtually because, you know, it folks can actually see it. We do it all. We do it all. Small. So when you're talking about appliances, we do small engine classes where folks can kind of bring in, you know, small stuff. They can't bring in their washing machine or their refrigerator, obviously, right. But try to do some, you know, some classes about that. And then one of my coordinators brought up doing kind of like life hacks, you know, or, you know, repair hacks, where there's simple things you can do, like, you know, to know if there's moisture in your basement, putting foil on the bricks, things of that nature. So, you know, we do every class. I wish I can, you know, we were in the same room. I would take you back to our teaching center, which is a full workshop that has a quarter of a house, which folks are able to do plumbing, lighting, everything. So we have it all here. It's just trying to figure out a way that we can, throughout this time, you know, get that information out to the community in a way that's engaging. We listed, I think last year we had 186 different classes over different topics, with, like I said, those reoccurring classes that we do quarterly. So we're the biggest need, even when we're out in the community, folks will always want to know about tuck pointing based on steps and masonry work. Drywall is always a big one, and faucets and plumbing, understanding how to change out faucets, fix traps, anything of that nature. So yeah.
That makes a lot of sense. So because I keep pushing it back, so I want to make sure I get to it. So you had talked about, you know, a couple of questions ago, you know, how you and your team were seeing that, you know, despite the fact that we're in this health crisis, we're in this pandemic, and, you know, associated with that are, you know, individuals unfortunately losing their jobs, there seems to be a growing interest in home ownership. You know, in kind of just talking, seeing colleagues and friends of mine and talking to folks who are in the house market, saying that there's been a big increase in demand, that people are looking, people are selling, people are buying. So curious from your point of view, as to, you know, just again, your personal point of view as to maybe a reasoning as to why we're seeing this right now, you know, and especially it seems like the market is looking for, you know, existing homes. You know, it's not looking, you know, too largely at a new home market, right? It's folks wanting to buy existing homes and, you know, potentially fix them up, you know. So just kind of curious of your two cents as to this increase in that.
You know, it's still kind of a miss. We've been talking with a lot of our colleagues as to, you know, why we see this kind of on an upward trend. And honestly, it's kind of what we were talking about before, is folks, you know, realizing their current situation, whether it be financially or, you know, in regards to, you know, residents, and wanting to, you know, improve it or better it, because we're going to be in it more going forward. So we're seeing that. And honestly, I just like my team said, if we don't know the answer, we always say we don't know. But it's kind of mind-boggling. You know, as I said, we're entering a recession. Unemployment is at an all-time high. You know, where you would think that folks would be hunkering down and maybe even, you know, living together more, or doing anything to kind of be more mindful of finances. I think they're realizing that, you know, home ownership is a sustainable investment, and that if, you know, you're more willing to be able to work with a mortgage company if you're unable to pay than, you know, a landlord, and that feeling of guilt versus dealing with an individual versus a company being or a bank. So we're still trying to look at the data and figure out why. The county just rolled out today their rental assistance program, and we've seen an uptick in folks wanting information about that. But those folks who pretty much were unable to pay or not being able to do that, I think what's happening is they've, you know, taken the funds that they would have paid for rent or, you know, other expenses and paired that with, you know, some savings that they perhaps had, and kind of putting them together to be able to have that sustainable generational, you know, asset that, you know, if something like this occurs in the future, or this, you know, remains to be the new normal, you know, going forward, they know that they've invested in themselves, invested in their families, and they have something that, you know, almost no one can ever take away from them. So I'll be interested to look at, you know, kind of some analysis that comes out. We figure we're only 3 months into it, being or 4 months into the pandemic. And I think municipalities, governments are really scrambling to be able to help residents as best they can with, you know, financial services. But, you know, I just really feel like folks are, you know, kind of changing their priorities and understanding what, you know, what means the most to them. And when you're dealing with a world pandemic, obviously finances and being able to sustain your family is one thing. But, you know, being able to do so in a house that you call home and you pay for is something I think is on the forefront of folks' minds. So I'll be interested to see what the trends and the data kind of say once we kind of move further past this point. But we're still trying to pinpoint as to why it's, you know, going the way it is. But we're really, you know, helpful and happy that folks are, you know, investing in their communities in this way, because, you know, hopefully it'll, you know, allow us to continue to support, you know, diverse communities where folks are, you know, it's a mix of renters and homeowners.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. I think it will be interesting because you think, again, you would think it'd be going in the opposite direction, mm-hmm. and it's increasing like it is. Maybe it is that more folks are spending, like you said, more time at home. So seeing that and probably spending more time watching those home repair shows. I know I get into them and then think, I'm like, oh yeah, I could do that, right? Like, which is what they just did, right? And in a half hour, and only
in a half hour segments,
right? Half hour segments. I can totally do that in half hour segments. They quickly show how it's like 2 weeks later or like 4 months later, how mm-hmm. long it takes to do something that you can just, you know, flip a home in a half hour and it's good to go. And, you know, you're making 20,000 more than what you paid for it and put into it, right? That's that's how the real world is all the time, correct? I mean, that's
absolutely. Yeah.
last question, just to kind of wrap things up. So as you see, you know, the organization now, and obviously this is going to be a slightly difficult question, I'm sure, because of the health crisis and the pandemic that we're in, but maybe not so because we're just talking about the rise in home ownership, but In your eyes, if, you know, if you were to forecast, look out, and I said, hey, Keesha, tell me what, you know, Home Repair Resource Center is doing in, you know, 5 years and 10 years, like what's kind of your vision for the organization as you continue to move forward?
Yeah, I see us being able to grow. I want to really still focus on the expansion of kind of our services. Maybe not in 5 years, but in 10 years, there should be, you know, a very equivalent home repair resource center on, you know, the west side of the county. And really, you know, having the resources to be able to serve the county as a whole. And the, you know, while we do have our brick and mortar here at Cleveland Heights, but, you know, growing our team to be able to, you know, have classes 5 nights a week, growing our team to be able to service even more folks with the incentive grants or loan programs that we have. So I see in 5 years, Home Repair Resource Center not being a secret anymore. And in 10 years, I see it being as kind of a household name for all things home for folks throughout Cuyahoga County. It's very interesting to field calls from all over the country to say, you know, I wish we had something like this in our community, and to really create relationships with, you know, all the municipalities within the county to say, hey, look, your residents will all benefit from the services that we provide, and how can we kind of incorporate and support your residents with through our programming. So being able to have, you know, more staff to be able to execute more programming throughout the county, and perhaps another brick and mortar at a different location, or something I see, you know, within the decade. But even through the pandemic, we're still focused on, you know, really getting the word out there to homeowners and residents that we are here as a support. We are here to empower you. We are here to kind of, you know, make this this whole situation a lot better by giving you the confidence and the supports you need to be able to stay at home or to, you know, live at home comfortably. So yeah, we're still focusing on, you know, this calculated expansion, we're not going to let the pandemic kind of get in the way of that, outside of being able to be in person with folks as much as we'd like to be.
No, absolutely. Keesha, if people want to find out more information about Home Repair Resource Center or be able to contact you guys, can you provide how to get in contact with you all?
Absolutely. Folks can visit our website, which is www.hrrc-ch.org. Our website, we just updated post-pandemic to have all information about classes, programs that we offer. You can always call our offices. We're here Monday through Friday, 9 to 5, at 216-381-6100.
Well, Keesha, thank you so much for joining me today and being part of our Home Chat series. Really appreciate everyone who's watching this video. Once again, we want to remind you that all of our events, again, we're doing the WePlanCLE 2020 virtual edition this year. So all of our event information is located on our website. It's www.ohioplanning.org/WePlanCLE. You can find this video, you can find other videos that we are recording and have recorded with other folks during our home chats. You can check out our Jane's Walks and our Jane's Bikes Rides. And then you can also check out all the articles that we're sharing with everybody, all related around our theme this year of home, which is perfectly selected as all of us are spending a lot more time here at home. So Keesha, I thank you again for joining us and taking the time to sit down and chat with me this afternoon.
Many thanks to you, Arthur. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, Keesha. Thank you, everybody.